Right. So before introducing, I would really like to thank you, Harshita, for having me on board, because, you know, webinar is something which I personally love. And okay, so for everyone who do not know me, I am Dhruvisha Jain. I am a content writer and a copywriter. To be very specific, a content writer turned into a copywriter. Okay, so yes, I've been working in this industry for close to 4 years. Even when I was working in my IT job, I used to pick up projects and, you know, deliver the copies to my friends and family, people who basically wanted all these sort of write-ups for marketing their own business. And after leaving my job, I was like, let me give it a shot. If it works, well and good. If it does not, I already have an IT job to continue. Right. So that is how I started my journey. And so one year after being into this industry as a full-time freelancer, here I am in front of all of you. And I'm really excited to, you know, meet everyone here.
Okay. So thanks for that introduction. It actually correlates with me too. So yeah, starting with the questions. The main issue people face is the main difference between the copywriting and content writing, and they are unable to differentiate and hence face some problems. So how would you like to differentiate between the two?
Okay, so if you ask me what's the difference between a content piece and a copywriting sample, so it's very simple. Okay, content is basically the details or the knowledge that you have written only with a purpose of educating, you know, the reader, or probably sharing a part of information that you already have. Okay, it has nothing to do with the ultimate purpose, wherein if you are writing a copywriting sample, the first question that comes to your mind or probably the reader's mind is, okay, why so-and-so person has written this particular content? Okay, so if I talk about copy, it's as simple as content that is written specifically to sell a product or a service. Okay, and if we talk about copywriting, so, you know, resources and email subscriptions, okay, landing pages, sales copies, and all of these content are basically a form of copywriting. And if you ask me what is a content, any article or blog that is written on a particular website is simple content with a purpose to, you know, spread awareness among the readers. So it's as simple as that. The only difference is the missing purpose, which you can fulfill through a copy.
Okay, yeah. So moving towards the next question is transition from a content writer to a copywriter without having much experience.
Okay, so I think, being a part of this industry, so similar was my case. I do not have a specific, you know, background of, let's say, communication media or marketing, advertisement. I've never studied any of these courses professionally. Okay, so what I did, I can share those tips and tricks with you. All right. So when I started writing content, the first thing that came to my mind is, okay, let me explore what is copy. Okay, I had no knowledge. So the first thing that you or me or anyone would do is probably do a Google search. What is copywriting? Right. So you get a definition, a content that sells is called a copy. Okay. Now, how to practically execute that particular statement? So what I did was I split the entire process in bits and pieces, and I'll share those bits and pieces with you. Okay. So the first thing that you can do is probably try to analyze what you've been doing so far. Okay, Harshita, is it okay if we pick someone from the audience and ask questions? Is that okay?
Sure, definitely. Even audience would be happy.
Perfect. All right. So, fair enough. I can see Divya on screen. Divya, can you please turn on your mic? Divya, am I audible?
Switch on your mic, if possible.
All right. Let's pick someone else. I can see Amrita Mishra on call. Amrita, can you please turn on your mic?
Hi, Dhruvisha. How are you?
Hi, Amrita. I am good. So I just wanted to know from you, what are you basically doing, currently doing professionally?
Sure. So currently I'm studying at IIM Calcutta. I'm in my first year. And I also have my own startup where I'm the like chief marketing head.
My goodness, this is something really good. I mean, okay, so I am talking to someone, having some authority in an organization. That's great. So Amrita, if I ask you, you have your own startup. May I know why have you joined this call?
I'm just always curious to learn about new things. So I joined to learn.
Okay, all right. Thank you so much. So now getting back to the question, how can you transition from a content writer to a copywriter? The first thing that you need to do is, what are you currently doing? Okay. Are you interested in writing? Because copywriting can be learned, but it can only be learned if you have interest in writing. If you are passionate enough to learn new things, it will work really great. You can learn copywriting, let's say, in 6 to 7 months if you are really serious about it. Okay. So what I did was, because I was from a content background, so I knew the basics of writing. Okay. I could do basic research, because when you write content, you need to do research, you need to, you know, generate a proper idea, you need to have a concept in mind, so that it can flow, you know, seamlessly on a paper. So identify the things that you are currently doing. Okay. Once you know research, once you know basic writing pattern, once you are clear with respect to communication, okay, if you know how to engage with your audience, you are already one step into copywriting. The next thing that you need to do is polish those skills in a far professional manner. Okay. So when we talk about copywriting, it's a industry specific skill. Okay. But every content writer can learn copywriting. The first thing that you need to do is probably learn from copywriters. So what I did was, when I started, because copywriting is a very vague term, and you know, despite having a lot of resources online, you'll feel like lost in the crowd, because there is genuinely a lot of resource on Google. Okay. So what I did was, rather than, you know, wasting time on doing Google search, I approached people who were already doing copywriting for, let's say, 1 year, 2 years, because anything more than me was good for me, right? So when I started working with those people, what happened? They were sharing templates with me. Apart from sharing templates, what they did was, they were already providing me with the right strategy. Okay, Dhruvisha, this is the first thing that you need to incorporate in your copy. This is the second thing that you need to do. This is the way you need to write. So all those things, you know, you'll get it on Google. There's no harm in it. But if you want to, you know, speed up the entire process, it's always good to connect with people who are already doing that. Okay, so that is what I did. I started working with those people. And when I was working with those people, what I did was, I was writing samples, which I used to discuss with them, you know, to understand where do I stand in the entire process. Okay, so those samples definitely were not paid samples. Those samples were never used. Some of them were never used. Okay, but what happened with those samples was, I could utilize it in my portfolio. Because in the end, if you are pitching your services to the client, he is not interested in which brand you've already worked with. He is interested in knowing if you are able to hook the audience, if you are able to connect with your audience, if you can engage your audience in a positive manner. And the last and the most important thing is, are you able to convert those readers? Right? Copy is all about converting lead gen or sales or anything, right? So whosoever your client will be, despite, you know, knowing that those samples were, you know, just written as for practice, but if he is able to sense those qualities in those samples, you are good to go. There's nothing more that you will need to it. Okay. The third thing that we need to focus on right now is, after you are okay. So definitely, Chaitra, I'll answer your question, and thank you, Jasmeet. So the next thing that we need to keep in mind is, while you are practicing copywriting, okay, there will be a lot of resources, that there will be a lot of people who can teach you. But eventually, everything boils down to, what are you doing? Okay, so what I did was, everyone was talking about, you know, practicing. Practice makes a man perfect. Okay, now how do you practice? Copywriting is not something which I learned, you know, from years or something which I've seen. So what I did was, I started picking up advertisements, or let's say emails, which were really appealing to me. Okay, because if something is appealing to me, I'll be able to understand why it is so, right? So what I started doing was, when I was working with clients, definitely they had a lot of projects. So I used to ask them to share those samples with me. Okay. The samples which I particularly liked, I made a swipe file of it. Okay. So swipe file is basically a collection of, you know, copywriting samples, which you can refer later. Okay. For later use. So what I started doing, supposedly if I liked the Colgate ad, okay, I used to download that ad and keep it on my system. So how will a Colgate's ad help me? So in future, if at all I need to write a copy about, let's say, mouthwash or Colgate or Pepsodent or anything, I can use those samples, right? So make swipe files as you learn copywriting. Pick up, you know, products or brands. There are a lot of brands. Like, okay, let's take example of Zomato. Okay. I am pretty sure everyone might have received at least one email from Zomato, right? Last week, I received an email from Zomato saying, kajra re, order to de ja re. Okay. So don't you think this is something which really catches your eye? When I was reading the email, I was like, yaar, koi professionally aise kyun likhega, right? Why will someone write a professional email in a, you know, lyrical song ka manner? Okay. But when I sat down to analyze, one thing is for sure, Zomato clearly knows what kind of, you know, content is being consumed by its audience. Okay. So when you collect those swipe files, when you go through, you know, those brand ka emails, those brands landing pages, start writing or start framing a copy of your own. Once you've read the entire copy, okay, close the email, close the landing page and rewrite the entire copy on your own. Okay. You might or might not copy the same statements, but definitely the concept will remain the same. The concept never changes. Okay. Try to put it across in a better way. Once you do it, what I did was I sent those, you know, critique samples to decent brands. And let me be very honest, one of them, I'm working with them on a retainer basis till date. It's been 7 months. I just rewrote a, you know, landing page. I saw his website. They had contacted me for weekly blogs. Okay. I saw their landing page on website. There were a lot of things which were missing. So what I did was I made a Google Doc. On that Google Doc, I mentioned all these suggestions that were, you know, good for a converting landing page. And I sent it to the client. The client was so happy that apart from the blog was definitely a good thing. But apart from the blog, I have the client on, you know, a retainer basis wherein I write this, you know, marketing campaigns for them every month. So don't you think it's a good idea? The worst that could happen was the client might have said, no, thanks. We already have a copywriter in place. We don't need you. Right. So rather than, you know, holding yourself back, go all out. Rewrite those copies, edit, you know, make changes and add some good things which you feel will be better. And definitely in this case, swipe files will work the best. Okay. What you can also do is go through your competitors' websites. Suppose you are working with Zomato. Okay. So who do you think are Zomato's competitors? Swiggy, Foodpanda, SendMe and all of these, right? So what you can do is go through their sales copies as well. Okay. Find out gaps. There might be certain cases where a person is talking about, let's say, a very lucrative offer. Okay. The other person might be talking about the benefits. The third person might be talking about testimonials. What you can add in your copy, figure out what is missing in your competitor's copy, add in your copy, and believe me, it will work like a secret sauce. Okay. So this is the third thing which I did. The fourth thing is start a blog. If you ask me, Dhruvisha, we don't see a blog of yours. I completely agree with that. I've been procrastinating it for a really long time, but believe me, I'll do it. I'll do it really quick. Okay. But the point of starting a blog is, you know, it does not matter which niche you are writing it. So whichever industry you are comfortable with, it can be
I guess there is some issue in your voice.
It can be beauty products. It can be, you know, food marketing, branding. All right. Am I audible now?
Yeah, you are audible. Hello? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah, you can continue.
All right. So, take it. So, the point of starting a blog is very simple. It does not matter whichever industry you are writing about, the passion for writing and you know the choice of words or probably the way you write, the style, the tone, everything becomes crystal clear to your client once they go through your blog. Okay. If you have a blog, well and good. If you do not have a blog, what you should do is collect all those, you know, free samples, write a lot. Okay. Collect those free samples and build a portfolio for yourself. So tomorrow, am I audible, Harshita?
Yeah, you are audible. Actually, there was some issue in the middle, but now you are clear.
All right. So, yes, we were talking about building a portfolio. So when you have your portfolio in place, what will happen is send it across to the client. Okay, let them analyze if you are the right fit or not. And when you are building your portfolio, make sure to, you know, accommodate a lot of samples. Now, the fifth and the most important thing in sending a portfolio is do not send one copy works for all. No, it does not work that way. If you are targeting a particular the automobile industry, and if you are sending samples about Zomato, Swiggy, so customize your proposal, customize your portfolio in a way wherein you are talking about relevant samples. Why did you work on those samples? What was the experience? What was the learning that you have from that particular industry? In case you do not have a writing sample or already published sample in one particular industry, there'll be a lot of writers who will say, don't write free samples, okay? But here, I will contradict a lot of them. Please write free samples if need be, okay? Because eventually you are in the beginning phase of your career, right? Don't limit yourself, okay, if the client will pay only then I will write a sample. No, it's okay if you write a free sample. Make sure that you do not give a 2000 word ka sample, okay? You can choose between 250 to 300 words. What time it will take? 1 hour or probably 1.5 hour, right? Send a free sample. Let the client analyze, okay? If it works well, you'll be hired. If it does not, use that sample in your portfolio, okay? But do not stop yourself from writing free samples. Choose. You should know when you connect with a client, the first thing that you will know is whether the client is, you know, genuine or not, okay? There's always this, sixth sense. I don't know what it is, but you'll at least understand, okay, I am willing to write a free sample or not. Don't stop yourself, okay? I think these are the five things which I made sure when I was, you know, transforming from a content writer to a copywriter. And if you ask me today, despite writing a lot of content, if you give me, you know, options, Dhruvisha, you have to write a copy or you have to write a content, what will you pick? Honestly, I'll pick up copy any day because copy gives me, you know, a vast horizon to expand. I can be as creative as I want to. I can try everything that I wish to. Could you just say the 5 points again? Sure, Deblina. So what I'll do is after this call, I'll share the summary of this entire call in the group. And apart from that, if you want to hear it right now, the first thing is try to understand what you've been doing so far, okay? The second point that you can do is start working with, you know, already working copywriters, people who've been in the industry for quite some time who can help you grow. The third thing is rewrite already published copies. Be a critic, okay? Add in anything and everything that you want to change in that copy and send it. Send it to the client. What will happen? They'll say an abrupt no on your face. That's okay. All right. The fourth thing that you can do is start a blog or far better will be publish a portfolio. Okay. It'll help you. And the last thing. Yes. And the last thing is do not send generic portfolios to everyone. Customize your portfolio in the right way. Okay.
There was a question.
Yes.
How did you find and identify clients?
Okay. So this is a really tricky question. Okay. So if you ask me, when I started out as a copywriter, the first client that approached me was through LinkedIn. Okay. So you might have heard a lot of people say LinkedIn is a gold mine of resources and you only need to be active. You need to churn quality content and, you know, let the leads flow in. So yes, I was lucky enough. I did the same thing for good 2, 2.5, 3 months. But yes, till date, every lead that I get is inbound from LinkedIn only. I do not use multiple platforms, although it is advisable if you have the time, if you are able to manage multiple platforms, you should do that. Okay, but what I did was I was okay using LinkedIn. So when, you know, clients were reaching out to me, what I did was please take us through the process. Okay, so through the LinkedIn process. I'm so sorry, Deblina. Are you trying to ask the entire LinkedIn? Okay, LinkedIn process. Okay, so LinkedIn is very simple app for professional connections. I would say it's not a professional platform. It's a pseudo professional platform, honestly. Okay, so what I did was when I started using LinkedIn, I used to post content daily. But as you know, people will not engage with your content until and unless they know who you are. So the same thing happened with me initially. For 1 week, 2 weeks, my post used to get 0 likes, 1 like, probably 2 likes, that too from people who already knew me. Okay, so that was like a really pathetic feeling. I used to, you know, question myself, am I so bad at writing that I don't even get 1 like? Okay, but then, you know, eventually when I used to consume a lot of content. So what I did was I started connecting with, you know, fellow content writers. And when I used to connect with those, I used to send a personalized note. I used to take the pain of going through the entire profile. I used to pick a post, the thing that I liked the most about that particular post. I used to send in a connection request and then I used to engage with those people. So initially 2 to 3 months, as far as I remember, I spoke to more than 100 people from LinkedIn. Believe me on that. I used to be on calls for 2 hours, 3 hours daily. So if you have the time, if you are willing to take the pain, it's really worth it. Okay. The next thing that you should do is while you are posting content on LinkedIn, make sure that you engage with other people's content. Does not mean that you have to, you know, just do it for the sake of doing it. Kisi ne post dala hai, humko engage karna hai, that is why we'll engage with post. No, it does not work that way. Pick a post that you like the most. If you have something really valuable to, you know, talk about, share your thoughts in the form of comments on other people's post. Okay, eventually your reach will increase. You are already posting your content. When you are posting comment on other people's post, their people, you know, the other person's network is able to see, okay, let's say Harshita, she's a person who has really, you know, good thoughts about a particular topic. Let's connect with her. So that is how basically your reach and, you know, your network can grow. So that is how LinkedIn works. LinkedIn is not a 1 day, 1 week or 1 month game. Believe me on that. It's not. If you think I'll post for a month and people should, you know, reach out to me, okay, Dhruvisha, please do this for us, it will not happen. Okay. But if you are willing to pour in efforts consistently, day in, day out, it does not mean you have to sit with LinkedIn for the entire day. Even if you are putting in 1 hour, make sure that you do it religiously, daily. Okay. Consume good content, post good content, and let the world know who you are. Okay. The topics, you know, what I generally did was I spoke about 4 topics. First is voice your opinion. If there is something which has, you know, anything to do with the entire society,
a voice issue.
Okay. The second thing which you can do is probably case study. Am I audible now?
I don't know what is happening. Actually, your video is going, but your voice is like limiting. Like voice baad mein aa rahi hai, video pehle aa ja rahi hai. Matlab aisa kuch ho raha hai beech mein. I don't know. Ye mere saath hi ho raha hai ya sabke saath?
No, there are some genuine glitches. Your voice is not properly audible sometime. There are some network issues. If you can check that out.
Sure. Just give me 1 minute. Hope this fixes. Am I audible now?
Yeah, you are audible.
Oh God, please. So this is some really strange panga with Vodafone and Idea, honestly. I'll change my service provider.
No, it is fine now. You're properly audible.
Okay, all right. So yes, what we were talking about is the kind of content that you can post on LinkedIn. One is you can voice your opinions on any particular topic that you feel like. does not, you know, it should not be politics. Believe me, once you make a bad impression in people's mind, even if people have or don't have anything to do with the topic, they'll, you know, form a judgment about you. And every time you post a content, it'll be like, you know, hit punching you, you in straight in face, in your face. Okay. So make sure that you don't post any controversial topics. Definitely you can voice your opinion in a very subtle way. The second thing is you can publish case studies. Suppose you are working with a client. Okay, you've worked on so-and-so particular project. These were your learnings, or let's say this was the outcome, how you help your clients. You can definitely share that. Personal experiences work really well. Stories, personal experiences work really well on LinkedIn. You can definitely do that. Okay, and the fourth thing was, recent, which is, you know, trending topics like Elon Musk. Okay, Elon Musk wala thing was all over the place on LinkedIn last night. Okay, so you can do that. So these are the four topics which I generally wrote and about.
Before that, the USA-India flag thing.
Yes, the USA-India flag thing. It can be anything, believe me. Every platform works differently, but once you figure out what works well with your audience, definitely you should understand, okay, this is the kind of content that my audience likes. Okay, so, you know, if I post humor or if I post inspirational stories, people really like it. I don't know why. And if you post something about, you know, marketing, branding, advertisement, people are like, okay, only if people, okay, thank you, Ria. So people are like, okay, only if I have anything to do with content and marketing and advertisement, I'll engage with that particular post. Okay, so you need to figure out what works well. Okay. So that is how LinkedIn works. And coming back to the previous question, how I got my clients. So I continued the same process. I was lucky enough to get my first client in the second week itself. The 14th day after I start using LinkedIn, I got a message in my inbox that, Dhruvisha, let's get on a call. I wish to understand. Okay, 14 days, I am not very sure what I posted on LinkedIn. But that was my first client, and that client is on board with, I am on board with that particular project for good 7 months now. So yes, I feel like it's a proud moment, but then that is how it happened. And slowly and steadily, you know, once I completed one project, then what I did was, it something is called as upselling. I'm sure some of you might be knowing it. So he approached me for one blog for his website. Then what I did was I took the project on a weekly blogger basis. After 2 months, I pitched him for weekly newsletters. Okay, so that is how you can, you know, keep a client on a permanent basis. Definitely, you have to pour in your inputs. But then, yes, you can continue working with your clients. So, yes, and identifying clients is very simple. Even today, last night, someone approached me that they want me to work on a SaaS platform. So they have a particular website. They are dealing with cloud computing and all of that. So he wanted me to rework the entire website. The client was pretty good. But I am 110% sure that I will not be able to do justice with that particular subject because I have zero interest in technology. So, you know, being from a computer science background, people approach me with lots of hope that, Dhruvisha, you have quite some knowledge about IT. You will be able to deliver the right content. But I don't know why. Wo kehte na, kick nahi milta hai. So if you give me, you know, random topics, beauty, personal brand, you know, let's say advertisement, marketing, personal finance, anything. And if you give me a high paying client for, let's say, SaaS platform, I'll happily, you know, ignore the SaaS wala client because I am not interested in that particular project. So, you know, this is the benefit which you can have as a freelancer. You can choose which clients you want to work with. So it's as simple as that. You don't have to identify. SaaS. So just 1 minute, Devlina. So you don't have to identify the clients. You can definitely choose. I want to work in this particular industry. Don't restrict yourself. Explore good 10-15 options in the beginning. Okay. See what works well for you. And then you can stick with that particular industry. Okay. So I think I've given a long answer for this question.
Actually, I'm enjoying your answers, you know. I am actually really relating, like being able to relate of what you are saying. Starting from the computer science background, then to a LinkedIn, because actually LinkedIn mein I started creating content just a week or two ago only. and I am like getting 10 to 15 personalized message, like what we say, requests daily.
Wow.
Like that was like people are approaching me and they मतलब मैंने एक या दो ही पोस्ट ऐसे डाले थे कंटेंट वाले एंड दे मैसेज्ड मी कि आई एम रीडिंग योर कंटेंट एंड आई एम रियली एंजॉयिंग दैट प्लीज ग्लैड टू कनेक्ट विद यू एंड सो एंड सो आई वाज लाइक ऐसा क्या डाल दिया मैंने इट वाज लाइक अ नॉर्मल पोस्ट बट देन आई स्टार्टेड एंड आई एम एक्चुअली मेंटेनिंग टू पोस्ट रेगुलरली बिकॉज दैट वाज आल्सो अ चैलेंज कि रेगुलरली पोस्ट करना है तो इसीलिए Yeah, actually, I started this 31 days of content challenge and I like requested people in my group to start this with me. Kyunki mujhe pata agar maine akele start kiya to 10-15 din ke baad wo khatam ho jayega. But agar ek group bana hua hai, sab log post kare ja rahe hai, to mujhe post karna hi hoga because maine start kiya hai, to of course I have to do. And sab log kare ja rahe hai, and usse unse matlab kafi bhi seekhne ko bhi milta hai. They are like amazing posts daily. तो उससे लाइक ये मैंने खुद स्टार्ट किया कि कुछ हो पाए कुछ कंटेंट क्रिएट हो पाए
ये सबसे अच्छी चीज है पता है खुद को कुछ करना है तो 10 लोगों को साथ में खड़ा कर दो इवन इफ वन डे यू फील लाइक ओके आई डोंट वांट टू डू इट देन बी पीपल यू नो पुशिंग यू डू इट डू इट डू इट डू इट सो फॉर मी लिंक्डइन वाज अ सिमिलर जर्नी आई डिडंट इवन थिंक ऑफ स्टार्टिंग माय लिंक्डइन प्रोफाइल देयर वाज वन पर्सन हु यूज्ड टू टेल मी तेरे को जॉब नहीं करनी है यू डोंट वांट टू डू बिजनेस व्हाट विल यू डू यू डोंट वांट टू डू अ स्टार्टअप क्या करेगी एटलीस्ट यूज लिंक्डइन सो दैट इज हाउ आई स्टार्टेड यूजिंग लिंक्डइन आई हैड जीरो नॉलेज ऑफ लिंक्डइन आई मेड माय प्रोफाइल इन 2014 व्हेन आई वाज इन कॉलेज एंड देन आई स्टार्टेड यूजिंग इट इन लॉकडाउन व्हेन यू नो आई हैड लिटरली नथिंग टू डू सो इज देयर सम क्वेश्चन Yes.
There was a question that how much time you have spent or struggled in this platform?
On LinkedIn?
Yeah, maybe on LinkedIn.
How many months did it take to you to come to this amount of good followers? Like how much time did it take? And obviously it is a struggle to upload daily, to think daily and to, you know, upload things to new thinking every day. It is a kind of experiment.
But I must say you are actually writing very good content. I was actually mesmerized by one of your story. That was like for a client, something related to client sent me a night message or something. I don't remember exactly. But that story was really good. And thereafter, I started to follow you and approached you. So that was it was. Yeah, you can answer your question, please.
Okay, so I think this was Pratiksha's question. So I would not say I struggled on this platform because when I started, I was like, theek hai, roj ek hi to post karna hai. And there are so many things you observe on a daily basis. So lockdown was the most important thing, you know, going everywhere. It was all over the place. So the first and the second post, which I remember I made were, had something to do with lockdown. Okay, work from home basically and the revolution that is about to come and all of that. So 7 months, it's been almost 7 months. And it was never a struggle, although now when I really have a, you know, some clients with whom I'm working and I do not get a lot of time to post daily. So now I miss writing content on LinkedIn daily. But again, yes, it was 7 months. In the initial 3 months when I was really struggling, I made some 8,000 followers on LinkedIn in 3 months. And I made a post about it because I saw everyone who had, you know, a decent number of followers were writing, okay, I have 10,000 followers, I have 50,000 followers. So it was a very initial stage. So being on LinkedIn for 3 months, I made a post about it that, okay, I got 8,000 followers in 3 months and so and so. And in the past 4 months, I think someone had already shared the figures. So yes, the remaining 42,000 followers or 40,000 followers I have got in the last 4 months. And the only reason is posting content daily. And it has to be, you know, quality content. Don't post any random thing. And keep engaging. Build a network because LinkedIn is a pseudo-professional platform. Believe me, I've made a lot of friends on LinkedIn whom I speak with regularly. I mean, daily. There's not a single day wherein I'm not in touch with those people. Okay, so yes, LinkedIn is has by far been the best journey. So,
okay, so should we continue with the audience questions? Mere questions reh gaye hain.
Definitely. I mean, I think audience ke questions zyada realistic honge. So, let's pick up, you know, really good questions jisse sabko thoda benefit ho sake, and I'm happy to answer anything and everything.
There was a like question that any resources to learn copywriting, any podcast videos.
Okay. So the resources which I follow is, if you want to learn copywriting, you know, subscribe to newsletters from really good copywriters. Because people who write really good copy, you'll be able to understand why that copy sells well, and try to incorporate those elements in your copy. Okay. So if you ask me the best copywriters, you can subscribe to weekly newsletters from Copy Blogger. Okay. The second is Copy Hacker. The third one is newsletters from Very Good Copy by Eddie. The fourth one is Quick Sprout by Neil Patel. Neil Patel is really good, you know, when writing copies. Apart from Neil Patel, copywriting. Okay, there's this copywriting course something, copywriting 101 something. So if you want, after this call, I'll share the link or basically the names of these resources in the group, and you can just go and check them out. So, but again, copywriting is something, Google it. You'll get N number of copywriters. You only need to see, you know, what sort of copy do you like? What sort of copy are you trying to learn? Some people write really creative copies. Some people write copies with a lot of pun. Some people write straight to the point copies. Some people write a lot of research-based copies. So figure out what works best for you and, you know, pick elements from those copies.
Hope it answers your question. And we have a next question that, how do you approach a copy requirement? Like, how do you go about researching, and what are your suggestions?
Okay. So, you know, when you write a copy, there are 2 to 3 things which you should have in your mind even before picking a pen or your laptop. The first thing is, your copy should completely be focused towards the reader. No matter whether your client likes it or not, it should, you know, be likable by the audience. Okay. There have been instances wherein, you know, clients have told me, no, Dhruvisha, we want a copy in a very, you know, straightforward manner. But looking at the target audience, it's very clear, you know, teenagers, let's say if you are talking to people from the age group of 13 to 19 or 20, probably. Okay. Do you think those kind of people are really in the mindset to understand a lot of facts and figures and statistics? I don't think so. Okay. So what you need to do is, once you know who you are writing for, your entire concepts should revolve around your target audience. That's the first thing. The second thing that you need to keep in mind is, write very specific copies. Okay. You cannot sell one copy to everyone. People from the age group of 0 to 50 will not follow the same advice that you've written in a single copy. Okay. Now, when we talk about how to start a copy, the first thing is, click-worthy headline. Okay. A lot of people say clickbait. I would say clickbait is the wrong word, because we do not want, you know, to make a lot of promises in the headline and give nothing towards the end. Okay. So your headline should be click-worthy. If a person reads, he should click it, and he should be in a mindset that, okay, let's read something further. Okay. The second thing which you might or might not incorporate in your copy is a subheadline. Because a lot of time there will be information that you wish to share with your audience in the initial 5 to 7 seconds. But if you make a headline really long, it makes no sense. Okay. So you can use a subheadline. Apart from the subheadline, the entire copy revolves around one central idea. Okay. Suppose if you are writing an ad copy for a, let's say, weight loss protein shake, something. Okay. If you are writing a copy for that particular thing, the central idea will remain the same, which is weight loss. Okay. The entire copy, all the arguments in the entire copy will be supporting arguments. You cannot have, you know, one copy and sell multiple products. That never happens. It has to be one idea and then supporting arguments. Okay. After this, what you need to do is, you can share some irresistible offers, because believe it or not, people really like offers. Free products, discounts, you know, FOMO, fear of missing out. People really like those things, and you know, hook your audience on these offers. Okay, so make sure whatever offer it is, it does not have to be a really big offer. You don't have to sell, you know, gift an iPhone to everyone. It can be very simple offers, but try to incorporate some. You can discuss it with your client. If your client has, you know, some budget and, you know, can spare that particular bandwidth, go ahead with offers. They work really well. Okay. Now, apart from offers, what you can do is write content wherein, you know, your audience can engage with you. Don't just go about writing blogs. The format of writing a blog is very different than writing a conversational topic. Okay. However, nowadays, a lot of, you know, bloggers have started writing in a conversational format. Make sure that the entire copy, when supposedly if I'm writing something, okay, and if you are reading it, the entire copy has to be in a single form. I am talking to you, not I am talking to all people. It has to be specifically oriented towards you. Okay. The next thing which you can incorporate is add some story. Okay. It does not have to be a Cinderella story always. It can be any personal story, let's say in a form of testimonial. It can be, you know, transformation of a person from 82 kgs to 60 kgs. Okay. So the core idea behind this particular story is your people do not purchase your product or services. People are least interested in what your product has. How does it matter whether, you know, your weight loss kit has 5 grams of carbohydrates or 50 grams? What matters is eventually what the result that your audience will get from those 5 grams or 50 grams, right? So sell your products on emotional basis. Okay, sell the benefits of your product. Don't go about boasting, okay, my product is these and these particular grams and it'll, you know, do XYZ things. Focus on, suppose if you are writing for, you know, weight loss clients, so focus on the, you know, transformation that they'll go through, the confidence that they'll get after they get slim, or, you know, talk about the thought process wherein people will look up to them as an inspiration. Okay, that, okay, she lost 20 kgs in 1 month. How? From this particular project, product. So the entire copy revolves around a formula, which is define the problem in the initial, let's say 30 to 40 seconds, then agitate as in prepare a story around it. Okay. Once you prepare a story, sell the benefits of your products. Okay. And towards the end, give a solution in the form of, you know, buy this, put a call to action. So call to action is something which is a primary difference between a content and a copy. Content may, you may or may not put a call to action, but your copy has to have a call to action. It can be anything. Purchase this free resource, purchase this course, you know, sign up for this 3-day workshop, anything. But your copy has to have a call to action towards the end. What works best and what I've seen missing in a lot of copywriters' copy is social proof and testimonials. Okay. Believe me, it might add like a chunk of paragraph in your entire copy. Try to keep it very short. You can put it across in the form of a quote. Okay, we had this in this particular client and this client has, you know, these two statements to share with you. But put it, because, you know, when you see, suppose if you ask me that X person has lost 20 kgs in 3 days using this and this particular product, I will have more credibility. Okay, the product works. If it worked for one person, it will work for me also. So add a lot of social credibility. Okay. And call to action, yes, towards the end. I think these are the elements of, you know, a good copy. And when you are writing about the product, when you are writing about the benefits of the product, do not write the features. Okay. So when you talk about researching, what all things do you need to incorporate in your copy? Always keep in mind that you do not have to share all the data in your copy. It has to be precise, to the point. Okay. You definitely need to make it really compelling. And to make it compelling, what you can do is research. How do you research? Check your competitor profiles. Okay. You can figure out who your buyers are, because definitely figuring out whom you are selling to will make a lot of impact. You will know what you need to write and how you need to demonstrate it. Okay. So yes, competitor research is one thing, and spend most of your time in researching. So if you ask me, if I have to write a copy of, let's say, 500 words, okay, Yes. So if I got to write a copy of 500 words, I'll spend good 2 hours to 3 hours in researching. Writing the copy of 500 words is what? 1 hour, 2 hour ka game. Right? But spend most of your time in researching so that you don't miss out on minute details. Okay? And just like Yash said, USP has to be crystal clear. USP as in what makes you different from your competitors. You will be able to figure out that USP once you do a thorough market research, once you understand what your competitors are offering and fill in the gaps. So the gaps that you fill in will be your USP. Okay?
Okay. There's a question that how to do SEO and can you explain the step-by-step process to do so?
Okay, fair enough. So if we talk about SEO and if you ask me, I simply use some tools. One is SEMrush, one is Google AdWords, keyword finder. What's it? Google Kai. Okay, so I use these tools. What you need to do?
Maybe.
Yes, Google keywords, AdWords and all of that. So use these tools. Answer the public, ask the public, answer the public. I don't know. I have all those tabs in my, Google pinned book. I've bookmarked all those tabs and I simply go there. What you need to do is, suppose if you are writing about, let's say, fitness products, okay? Put in this particular keyword as in fitness product and, supporting keywords. Suppose what can go around with fitness, weight loss or let's say, health, nutrition, wellness. Okay, so put all these keywords in these tools, okay, and figure out what the audience is generally looking out for answers. So you'll find, suppose if you have entered all these in the tools and, Google gives you a suggestion, how to get fit in 30 days, or let's say, what should be the perfect fitness quotient, or let's say, which is the best fitness app. Okay, so you will get a list of questions. See what your readers are asking and then use, write on those topics. And the keywords will definitely come from all these. You can go through your your competitor's website, figure out what keywords are working well and simultaneously use it. Even Neil Patel's SEO keyword planner, even that will help you a lot when you are trying to figure out keywords. Okay. And I'll be very honest, I am not. Uber Suggest is another really good, tool which you can use for SEO. And I'll be very honest, I am not the one who does SEO. So, I have a person who is specialized in SEO. So he helps me with all the keywords and I simply use those keywords. But whenever you are writing a content which is rich in SEO, make sure that you do not, stuff it with irrelevant keywords. Don't just do it for the sake of doing it. Let it go in a natural flow. Okay. It should not be overloaded with keywords. Let it be very simple, very sorted and very concise. Okay.
Yeah. And for the same, we already had a session on SEO. So people may check that also.
Oh, I think I also need to check that.
Okay. So yeah. Can you share your approach for newsletters copy?
Okay, so I'll be honest, be it a newsletter, be it a landing copy, the elements remain the same. There's no change in the elements. When we talk about a subject line, you should have a really appealing subject line, a very brisk introduction. You have to go about the same process, which is describe the problem, agitate, and then provide a solution. It should have a call to action. You should write for your audience. Then, talk about the benefits. Don't talk about the features of your product. So creating irresistible offers, all these things remain the same in any copy that you write. The only thing is placement of the content and, the length. Suppose if you are writing a website copy, a website landing page, you can have a long copy. Okay, you can talk about everything in detail. Okay, but if you are writing a newsletter, what I generally do is I really... write newsletters which are to the point, very crisp. Because if you ask me, or probably the audience for which I am writing is teenagers or people who are below 30, not very serious about reading newsletters. ठीक है. सो वॉट आई जनरली डू इज नो मैटर वॉट फॉर्म ऑफ कॉन्टेंट यू आर राइटिंग, अंडरस्टैंड हु योर रीडर इज. इज दैट पर्टिक्युलर पर्सन इंटरेस्टेड इन रीडिंग अ लॉन्ग फॉर्म कॉन्टेंट, इज ही नॉट. यू विल गेट ऑल योर आंसर्स वंस यू स्टार्ट एनालाइजिंग योर कॉन्टेंट. Okay, so there are a lot of tools from where you can know how many people have opened your email, how many people have, you know, visited the website, how many people have spent, how much time on that particular blog. Go through all those analytic data and then figure out, okay, what form works best for that particular audience. So everything boils down to one, you know, one specific thing, who you are writing for. Okay, the elements of every copy remain the same. There are one or two things which can, you know, probably be up or down, but nothing, there's no major change. The only thing that varies is presentation, the way you present to that particular audience. Okay, most welcome, Simran.
Okay, so there is a question that if a client asks for a copy sample and yours is genuinely good, but the client does not want to proceed further. Later, mm-hmm. you realize that they have used your sample. How to handle this?
Okay. So, as I told you, so far, this has not happened with me. Honestly, this has not happened with me. So, I don't think I'll be in the best position to answer it. But supposedly, if this happens you know, if you already have a written sample and still the client is insisting on writing, you know, a similar sample, if I would have been in your place, I would have denied. At that particular point, I would have denied, because I have, you know, quality content relevant to the industry, relevant to the company, which they can probably evaluate me on. But if they are not willing to evaluate me, it's better not to take that particular call. Okay, if you are writing it and, you know, supposedly if the other person is using the same content, the same copy in that particular resource, I would rather be upfront, speak with the person. Eventually, I cannot do anything about it because I am not someone who will get into the legality and everything. But yes, there are definitely options wherein you can approach law and order. They'll help you if there's a case of plagiarism. But again, it's a time consuming process and I would rather invest that particular time in finding new clients. Okay, so had I been in your place, I might have done this.
So yeah, there is a question that how to build the ideal client's persona.
Okay, so I think building the ideal client persona was discussed by Ruchi, right? In day before yesterday's webinar. Okay, so I was lucky enough, I, you know, heard that
particular... them a brief, yeah.
Oh, pardon?
Yeah, you can just give them a brief about the topic. Yeah.
Okay, so fair enough. So, you know, the most important things that you need to consider when you are building a, you know, buyer persona is basically the demographics of your audience, who your audience is, which is the first thing. The age group that they belong in, you know, the, let's say if you are talking about a seasonal fruit, okay, a seasonal product, you should also consider the location or or preferably the geography where the audience is based, their social interest, okay, whether, you know, suppose if you ask me, people within the age group of 15, let's say 10 to 40 will be really active on Instagram. And people who are really professional, if you are writing for your professional clients, there are very high chances that they'll be super active on LinkedIn. So you need to consider all of these things, you know, before making a complete buyer persona. Once you have it in place, alpha beta test it. This is what I generally do. You know, despite writing really good content or despite writing a landing page for a website or a sales copy, what I generally do is alpha beta testing, because that will help you, you know, get real time answer to your questions.
Okay. So yeah, there is a, like, can you tell about pricing?
Okay. So pricing for content or copy? Copy. All right, great. Take care. So, okay, there are, this is a really tricky question because I'm not very sure. To be very honest, I don't have a fixed rate card. So I'll tell you what I generally do is, the first thing is you need to understand if it's a copy or a content. Okay. Once you know it's a copy, you already know, you know, that your particular write-up will help the client generate leads. He'll be making money out of it. So you need to take 2 to 3 things into consideration. The time that you will take in framing the, you know, perfect copy. Time has to be one very important factor. The second thing is it a long-form copy or a short-form copy? Okay. If you are writing a long-form copy, you can have X prices. Let's say you are quoting 10,000 for a long-form copy or for a website landing page. Okay. If you are writing a very crisp email copy, let's say of 200 to 300 words, you can quote somewhere between 3,000 to 5,000. The third thing which comes into place is who your client is. Okay, always know who you are asking money from. So this is what I generally do. Rather than quoting, you know, a straight figure to all my clients, when I get to know their particular website, when I get to know which industry they are dealing with, when I get to know the product and services, when I get to know, you know, from my copy, how much ROI are they going to make? That is how I decide my prices. So that's what I generally do. And yes, I think in a copy, these things do matter. You know, time, your client, and, you know, the ROI that they'll be making. There are some people who also write copies and nominal prices, but what they do is, you know, they sign up on a contract basis or a commission basis. So suppose if I've written a copy for 2,000 words, okay, and let's say the product, you know, is between a price range of 50 rupees to 100 rupees. So they take a commission of, let's say, 5% or 10% on every sale that they make. So you can do anything which works best for you. Deblina, 2,000 to 3,000 rupees for 200 words. Yes. And I'll be very honest, it can be even more. So all you need to do is polish your skills. Polish your skills, be a complete package. Give them a complete, you know, copy, starting from an amazing headline. The first thing that you need to do is close your client. Okay, if you are able to close your client with that copy, believe me, every consumer is similar. Okay, so you know what will happen. And there are people who charge even more than this for a copy of 200 words. Most welcome.
Okay, so like I can't see any more questions. Till then, I can ask mine too.
Sure.
Most of them are covered in the questions you have answered only. There is like one question that how to stay motivated as a writer.
Oh, this is a wonderful question because I think I lacked motivation the most. See, the most difficult thing is when you are working as a freelancer and taking into consideration the present scenario, everyone is working alone, right? So staying motivated is a really big challenge for most of us. What you can generally do is the first thing that you need to make sure as a writer is don't be a self-critic, okay? Because that will not help you anywhere, okay? What we generally do is we write 2 statements and we start analyzing. Is it good enough? Is it not? How will the reader, you know, react on this particular statement? Stop doing that, okay? It will not help you. Whenever you start writing, write something. Even if you wish to write 1 paragraph, 2 paragraph, complete it in one go and then start editing. What we generally do as beginners, which I also did, was I wrote 2 statements and I started editing it. Okay, let's put because pehle and let's put the, you know, subject later on and all of those things. Don't do it. The first idea or, you know, the concept of writing content is write down everything that you have in your mind first and then start editing. Okay. The second thing that you can do to stay motivated is probably prepare a timetable for yourself. This is what helped me because now that you have 24 hours to work, what you generally do is, okay, let me not do it right now. I'll do it later on. Okay. And this procrastination never ends. Okay. So what I do right now is I work from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., which is fixed. Then I work directly at night. So that is what works well for me because when everyone is asleep, I can, you know, go all out. So I work after 11 p.m. at night. Okay. The third thing which you can do is praise yourself. Every time that you write a copy, now, be happy about it. You are far better than a lot of other people. At least you are utilizing your time. Okay. So you can definitely motivate yourself. What you can do next is keep writing. वंस यू थिंक अभी नहीं करेंगे, लेट्स डू इट लेटर ऑन, यू विल रिपीट इट. ओके, सो डोंट डू दैट. ओके, what else can you do to stay motivated? A lot of physical exercise. It can be anything. You can go out for brisk walks. You can do, you know, yoga at home. You can do Zumba at home, because now with internet available everywhere, you have a lot of free classes, YouTube, everywhere. If you like cooking, do it. You know, involved in recreational activities that will help you, you know, keep sane. That works best for me.
So there is question that should I mention my pricing on the portfolio site or give it to them only when the client approaches?
Okay, so I have not uploaded my prices on any site, not even in my, you know, proposal or even in my, you know, portfolio. So my suggestion would be don't, until and unless you plan to quote the same price to everyone. It's your call, but suggestion is don't. Once the client approaches you, have a complete discussion. Understand what the client wants. Understand if he has any additional requirements. Evaluate, you know, how your copy or your content will help the other person. Figure out if he wants the project on a one-time basis or a monthly basis or a weekly basis. And then share your proposal. Okay. So for clients, you know, if client has a one-time requirement from you, you can have X amount. If a client is, if you ask me, if a client is working with me on a retainer basis, I offer an upfront discount and I'm happy doing it, because I know that even if that 10% is helping me get the same recurring amount for 6 months, there's no harm in it, right? So, you know, always share your prices when the client asks you for. Even if the client is insisting that nahi, aap pehle price batao, give me an upfront price or give me an approx price. Share an approx price, but don't be, you know, very sure that, okay, I'll be charging this in this particular amount only.
Relevant books we can read.
Relevant books? I'm not very sure about books, but there is this one book which I really like, is Cashwordizing. Okay, I'll share the link. I have it on Kindle and everywhere. You can purchase a hard copy of that book. There are a lot of books. In fact, you know, not only specific to copywriting or content, I think if you want to be good in copywriting, you should read books which are more oriented towards, you know, sales. Let's say closing, effective, you know, asking effective questions, or The Art of Persuasion. These are, you know, very soft. These are the soft skills which will not help you only write the copies, but will also help you in closing your clients. So if you ask me, I read books like Questions Are the Answers. So the whole and soul concept of reading that book is, you know, I know my next statement when, you know, my client asks me a random question. So, you know, if a client is asking you X question, put a question over it. Until and unless you have a genuine answer to give. But, you know, when we talk about objection handling, let's say a client is telling you, no, Dhruvisha, you charge a lot. Cross-check, you know, counter it with a question. More in what sense? Let him be in the answering position. Once you build that authority with your client, believe me, it'll continue for a very long time. And, you know, if you leave the ball in the other person's court, it'll always be like you are agreeing to whatever he or she has to say. Okay.
Okay, I guess the questions are... There is a question that how to be unique.
How to be unique? Okay, I think the answer lies in the question itself. Everyone is unique, be it you, be it me. If you are asking how to be unique with respect to copy or content, the only thing that matters is the way you present it. Because if you are writing about dairy milk, okay, the features will remain the same. It's a sweet, it's, you know, it has so and so carbohydrates. Everything will remain the same. The only thing that matters is how you sell dairy milk. Okay, so, you know, the way Harshita thinks about dairy milk will be far different than what I think about dairy milk. So all you need to do is, you know, write what you feel about a particular product. Once you do that, you are unique. The core idea will remain the same. Competitor research will also give you, you know, these ideas. But when you are, you know, sitting down to write on a particular topic, don't, you know, absorb a lot of information, because what will happen is, this happened with me in the beginning, you know, what we tend to do is, when we are researching in the beginning, you know, start absorbing all the information that you get. Suppose last week I was writing about, you know, the benefits of soft skills. Okay, so benefits of soft skills will help you, you know, build a really good personality, blah, 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 everything. So when you research from your competitors, you start to, you know, mug up all these answers. Don't do that. If you think that, you know, everything is getting on your head. Am I audible?
Yeah, yeah, you are audible.
Okay, so if you think that, you know, you are, you know, literally learning everything, don't do a lot of research in the beginning, because what will happen is you'll end up copying everyone else's idea. Okay, so once you get a topic, the first thing that you can do is probably write down all the pointers that you have in your head and then start researching. It will help you, you know, get a completely fresh perspective of the idea. Okay.
Yeah, I guess that's the question. And yeah, all my questions are over.
Oh, God. So I think we've covered a lot of questions, and
maybe some of them were already covered in the audience questions.
Yes. So, and the last thing that I would like to, you know, convey to all of them is, if you have any more questions with respect to copywriting, if you wish to, you know, see how I work, then I can definitely share a few samples. You can go through those samples, you know, try rewriting those samples. And if there is anything else which you want more clarification on, you can connect with me on LinkedIn, Instagram. I think we, all of you are also in the group, the FIFO Talks wala group, WhatsApp group. So you can drop me a message on WhatsApp also, and I'll be more than happy to answer all your questions.
Thank you, Shaleen, for attending.
Thank you, Shaleen. Thanks a lot, Dublino. Thank you, Ruchi.
Hey, Dhruvisha, you were amazing in today's session. Like, I really liked your answers. Thank you so much for sharing your valuable knowledge with us. It means a lot.
Thank you so much, Jasmeet. Thanks a ton for attending. Thank you, everyone, for, you know, sitting and listening to me for the last 1 hour. And I really hope that you'll, you know, every one of you will write one copy at least. And let's give it a shot. Send it to whichever brand you like. Give it a shot. And, you know, keep those samples. If you want any help, drop me a message.
Yeah, I guess we can end this session now if people don't have any more questions. Yeah, I can't see any more questions. Thank you so much for this session, Dhruvisha. Thanks a lot. Yeah, have a good day. Bye-bye. Bye,
thank
everyone.
You so much for having me.
Yeah, thank you, everyone, for attending.